So now we move into the indoor environment. And just so I can get a feel for how many people are familiar with the subject matter, who has a cat? And does anyone of those people that have cats have a cat that has hypothyroidism? Not yet? Are they old yet? Okay, you're lucky. So it's a very, very common disease. And in the interest of time, I'm just going to give an abbreviated talk. This is a subset of the information from my thesis. But we'll investigate the connection potentially between PBDEs and feline hyperthyroidism. And for those of you who are unaware of what it looks like, this is actually a thyroid adenoma in a cat that's anesthetized under the surgery to remove it. And then I'm assuming that most of you are familiar with the structure of polybromate. We've got that over here. There it is. Okay. So feline hyperthyroidism is characterized by an autonomously functional thyroid adenoma. So it's a cancer technically, but it's not a malignant cancer. It's analogous to the human disease called toxic multinodular goiter, or TMG, and it's characterized by excessive thyroid hormone, which drives your metabolism. So these cats are hypermetabolic. They get incredibly skinny despite a ravenous appetite. They're often really, really thirsty. They urinate a lot and drink a lot. They do often vomit. They have unkempt coats. Typically, they look really ratty. It's predominantly a geriatric disease. It was discovered in New York City in 1979. It's the most common endocrinopathy in cats. And again, it's a benign disease in terms of malignancy, but the quality of life is very poor. There have been a variety of epidemiologic studies that have looked into a lot of factors with regard to development of hyperthyroidism, and I've listed some of them with the odds ratios in parentheses. And among all of the studies, indoor housing and fish-flavored foods being ingested tend to be fairly common findings. But there are discordant results with regard to other factors. I just want to point out that in this instance, a hybrid vigor isn't a good thing. And I just want to point out that the non-Siamese breed and non-Himalayan breeds are predisposed. But these odds ratios are actually for the breed specifically. So they're protected being purebreds. So it's an interesting array of factors. And for those of you who are unfamiliar with PBDEs, they're very widely found flame retardants, and they've been manufactured since the early 70s. The exact date, I found a hard time. I really didn't find it in terms of when they were initially on the market, but early 70s tends to be the closest that I can get. And the PBDEs are just like PCBs, they have 200 non-contours, and so depending upon the location of the rodent on the rings, you can have a combination of 209. There are three commercial mixtures. The pentaform is so mean because it had predominantly the congeners with five bromines. The octaform has predominantly eight bromines, and then the decaform has all 10 of the phenylamines with bromines in. And I won't go into all the legislation, but there's been a lot of action in recent years to ban these products. So penta and octa pretty much were the first targets of that because of potential endocrine disruption effects. The EU, the European Union, has been really proactive in doing legislating against them. And then in recent years, even here in the States, DECA has been the target of that legislation. So I alluded before, where are PBDEs? They're pretty much ubiquitous. They're everywhere. And they are not covalently bound in products in which they are used, so they do leach out into the environment, both indoor and outdoor. So I suspect that there's really no place on Earth now where they're not. So they really, truly are everywhere. With some of the products like foam padding, it's purported to be up to 30% by weight of PBDEs rather than the actual foam. This is just for comparison. Since this was one of the first studies to look at domestic animals with PBDEs, I just give you some of the wildlife studies with the residues that have been found. I haven't updated the literature search in the last year or so. There may be others, but at the time of my study, the peregrine falcon egg was the highest contaminated wildlife specimen. The one thing, too, I'll just mention, polar bears, since these are they're lipophilic and they biomagnify in organisms, you would expect the top predators to have the highest levels. So you can see that relatively, the polar bear doesn't have such high levels, and it's a notable exception that they're thought to be able to metabolize PBDEs. So I'll briefly go over some of the endocrine disruptive properties of these compounds. They have been shown to be neurotoxic, and they impair spontaneous behavior. So they decrease habituation and cause hyperactivity. They also alter learning and memory, and it's been potentially linked with the development of attention deficit disorder in kids. And then on the thyroid end, you can see the structural similarity between thyroid hormone here and the hydroxylated metabolites of PBDEs. It's easy to understand that there would be some endocrine disruption in the hypothalamus.
Can you go back a couple of slides?
Sure. This one?
No.
One more?
So in the left-hand side, there is a tub.
Yeah.
What's going on there?
And so they put rodents in the tub, and they try to swim until they can get to the podium. And the rodents that were exposed to PBDEs couldn't get to the podium as quickly as the ones that were not exposed. So their memory of where the podium was decreased.
Thank you.
Sure. And so with the hypothalamic pituitary axis, there are various levels at which endocrine disruption can occur. And so it's been shown experimentally that PBDEs affect metabolism of thyroid hormones, the effect on anxiety and PGT. Way back in 1975, one of the manufacturers did a study and found thyroid hyperplasia among the treated animals. So this is the thyroid, the histology of the thyroid gland. Hyperplasia is just excessive growth. Curiana et al. Showed decreased thyroid hormone levels in exposed animals, as well as the pups of exposed dams. And then Mears et al. Showed that carrier proteins can carry, the thyroid carrier proteins can carry PBDEs. And then there's also some effect at the level of thyroid receptors in the pituitary. So multiple levels of interference. So our research objectives, it's really a pilot study. So first we just wanted to find out if the PBDEs were in domestic cats. Nobody had looked before, so we just wanted to find out if PBDE levels in the serum, and we did a few adipose samples, but that really wasn't a major player. It was harder to get adipose tissue from domestic cats than we had hoped. But predominantly in serum, we looked to see if in the euthyroid, which are normal thyroid healthy animals, versus the hyperthyroid cats, was there a significant difference in contamination? And then, so we go to that first, go to the second aim of the study a little bit later. So enter ISTC, formerly WMRC, and we did our analyses here. We extracted the serum samples of the liquid extraction. I'll talk a little bit about dust and canned food samples where we used pressurized fluid extraction. We cleaned up the samples and fractionated them with silica gel chromatography, and then further cleaned up with GPC. We analyzed 15 different congeners. The ones in red are those at the time that were deemed to be environmentally relevant or primary congeners of interest by the EPA. We used GC, high resolution mass spec for that. And then we also determined the lipid composition of the serum so we could standardize the results into lipid weight, which allows us to compare them with other published values. And so here at the lab, we had a lot of QAQC. We used blanks and reagent blanks, duplicates, spike samples, we used surrogates, regular new compounds, and then also internal samples to maximize our precision and accuracy. Here we have the results of the serum PBDEs in nanograms per gram, lipid weight. We got a total of 62 cats. They were all client-owned, mostly indoor. These were all predominantly from Chicago, so an urban environment. The range of PBDEs in the client home cats all together was pretty wide, 370 to 51,000, with a median of 2615. 21 euthyroid cats were included, and 41 hyperthyroid cats. There was no statistically significant difference between these two populations, euthyroid and hyperthyroid. We also serendipitously had somebody get interested in the product and in the project and offered to give us samples from feral cats, and that was in California. So we included 8 feral cats. We presume that those were younger cats, since we don't know exactly their age, since the outdoor environment is typically a bit more dangerous. So we figured they were young cats, and the range of PBDEs was much smaller, 460 to 3700 nanograms per gram. And we did find that that was statistically significant with both the euthyroid population and the hyperthyroid population. This is a, since our euthyroid and hyperthyroid cats were age matched, we wanted to look at the levels of serum PBDEs with respect to their age and see if there was a trend, since we would expect that with time, as these compounds bioaccumulate, that you would have higher levels as you age. And it wasn't statistically significant, but there is a trend with increasing age. So it's kind of interesting to see. And then the second research objective was to evaluate the PBDE content of commercially available canned foods for cats, and then also household dust to try to determine what the primary source of exposure might be. So this was the very, very first thing we did, not knowing what was going to be out there. Mark Thorne and I went shopping and bought predominantly fish-flavored foods, thinking that most of the literature had high residues in marine environments. We went for fish-based foods, and we really didn't find much. We sampled 10 different brands, with just a duplicate here, just to kind of see what the variation was, and we really didn't find much in the way of residues in canned food. But with the dust samples, we were able to obtain 19 dust samples among the from the homes of the participants. 12 of those were thyroid cats and 7 being hyperthyroid cats. We had a dramatic difference between the two. You can see 510 to 4900 nanograms per gram for the euthyroid cats versus up to 95,000 in the homes of hyperthyroid cats. And that wasn't an outlier for 95,000. And the difference there was significant. So not knowing exactly how many ounces of food each of these cats would have ingested, we took an average, assuming that they eat only canned food, an average of about 5 ounces of food per day, assuming an average 5 kilogram cat body weight. We went and calculated the range of PBDEs that they would ingest and the mean from the values that we found in those samples. So it was relatively small, 12 to 91 nanograms per kilogram per day. But from the dust, we used the EPA's assessments for ingestion, average ingestion of dust by toddlers. So that was 200 milligrams of dust per day. Since cats are really fastidious groomers, we assume that they would have the same kind of exposure as a child that's constantly putting things in their mouth. And this could be an underestimate. So it's just, it was a standard that we could at least extrapolate to. And so with that, we got a mean of 320 nanograms per kilogram per day with a pretty wide range of 20 to 3800. Then we took those two and combined them and compared them with known levels that have been shown to cause endocrine disruption in the laboratory. And so if we use the high end, just to be a bit more dramatic about it, it represents 1.3% of the lowest single acutely toxic dose known to disrupt thyroid function. So within 3 months, that animal is exposed to 100% of that dose that's known to be toxic. And since hyperthyroidism is a geriatric disease, that 3 months over 13 years, it's going to be a considerable load with these compounds that are active ion magnified. So in conclusion, we know that domestic cats are highly exposed to PBDEs. So at the time of my thesis, it was the highest reported level on the planet, and might have been trumped by now. And total PBDEs in serum do not significantly differ between client-owned euthyroid and hyperthyroid cats in our study. The feral cats had significantly lower PBDE burdens than both euthyroid and hyperthyroid cats, and that may be age-related, maybe environment-related, it could be dietary, it could be a combination of all of those things. We suspect that dust is likely the primary route of exposure to domestic cats to PBDE, since they are such good groomers. And then total PBDEs were significantly higher in dust from homes of hyperthyroid cats versus homes of euthyroid cats. So the question of my thesis was, are PBDEs a good model for endocrine disruption for feline hyperthyroidism? And it wasn't a smoking gun, but there is evidence that PBDEs are at the scene of the crime. So the answer is maybe. And definitely we need more research. We need feline-specific pharmacokinetic studies just to know what each of these individual contours does in the cat. We need to know what happens at various levels of the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. We need to know what happens at different ages. Developmentally, is this something that happens really during gestation? And you know, these cats don't start manifesting signs of disease until later in life. We need to know breed-specific issues. Why are the Siamese and the Himalayan breeds not so prone to hyperthyroidism? We need to know what happens at the level of the brain. And then there's also environmental fates of the PBDEs. They've been shown to be photodegraded as well as to be degraded by certain bacteria. So all of those studies need to be done so we can find out exactly what the relationship may be. And then the broader implications with using the cats, the theory was that they might be actually the canary in the coal mine for people. And since PBDEs have only been on the planet for about 40 years now, we haven't actually had a lifetime for people. And so if it's a geriatric disease, we may need 30 or 40 more years before this starts to show up in people. And so the hope was that at least this initial pilot study would encourage others to look further into the mechanisms and try to find out if it's indeed something that we need to be looking at on the horizon. It's a concern for particularly firstborn infants in terms of some of the altered learning and memory. The firstborn infants get the bulk of the contaminant load through breast milk, and so it's a big deal for them. With the attention deficit disorder, I think most people know somebody who has a child who's on Adderall or Ritalin, and so that's definitely a big factor in society today. And then I mentioned the geriatric population in 30 or 40 years. And then for the kids that are constantly putting things in their mouth, we need to know what they're exposed to and what the implications are. So with that, I'd like to thank my committee, Dr. Beasley, Dr. Ferguson, Dr. Schatz, and Tom Gray, Dr. Graves, and then all of the hospitals that participated with me in Chicago, and Veterinary Information Network for recruiting the California samples. The funding was predominantly from the ISTC, I have a different slide for that, but also the Campus Research Board initially, the statisticians, Dr. Schaefer and Dr. Slater, and then the departmental staff at the Veterinary Biosciences Department. And then I'd also like to thank all the cats that were in the study, although they didn't actually volunteer their time, but I appreciate their participation. And then obviously the ISTC, formerly WMRC, John Scott, particularly for all his help. That's it. Thank you.
Do you think there are cats who are much lower?
It is, yeah. There's a study, I didn't include it just for brevity's sake today, but there's a study by Guy et al. That came out in 2007, and they did make it dry food, and they found that there was significantly less food.
Sure. you mention this or not, but has there been a big increase in this incidence of this since the 70s?
Yeah, hyperthyroidism as an entity was pretty ubiquitous around the mid-80s. So it was in New Zealand, in North America, in all places in between. But there have been incidences in a 20-year span from like 1980 to 2000. It's incredibly increased. And it's not just an age-related phenomenon. The actual incidence is greater.
What explains the huge difference between the PBD levels in the dust samples from one home to the other?
I would love to answer that question. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Because that's a significant difference.
Yeah. And the one thing we didn't have the luxury of doing would be repeated samples in the home, sub-sampling different rooms in a home over time. So there are just a tremendous number of studies that can be done to try and answer that. No, it was first recognized in 79, and with PBDEs starting in the 70s, early 70s, the time difference is pretty incriminating in terms of the typical age of the cat that becomes hypothyroid about 9 years.
Are there other fire retardants that would be better?
I'd like to say yes. And there, unfortunately, with the PBDEs being phased out, there are other products that are being phased in. And most of them have similar activities. They're the bromine. ESEF is the foundation of bromine manufacturers. And so they want to do something with the bromine that PBDEs can be used. So some of the substitutes are just as apt to be endocrine disruptive. And the thing too is a lot of the chronic effects aren't tested. So we don't know what happens over the lifetime of the cat or some of the pre-manufacturing studies.
Yeah, what is the basis for your expectation that even in PBDEs where to cause hyperthyroidism, that it get reflected in serum levels? Now, what is that lineage? Why should it persist? Why not? Why can't it be at a lower level and still cause?
It certainly can. And with this being a pilot study, we just wanted to see if they were there. And if it were, if we got lucky enough that there would be a dramatic difference indicating exposures, exposure yes in the hypothyroid group, exposure no in the thyroid group, that would have been a smoking gun. But it's very possible that it could be seen at much lower levels. And yeah, we don't know. Our study wasn't designed to specifically address that question.
How do you collect dust samples? It looks like you're going to need somebody's vacuum cleaner.
We did, yeah. We asked folks to put a sample of the dust from their vacuum into just a plastic baggie and submit it.